Hello everyone, my name is Robert Schulze, I work at ClickHouse, and I'm going to present how we built a powerful new JSON data type for ClickHouse. This is a re-recording of the presentation which I gave live at FOSDEM 1.5 weeks ago. Unfortunately, the start and end timestamps were somehow off and major parts of the presentation are missing from the original recording. I'm now going to present the same content and slides like at FOSDEM. I like to mention that credits for this cool new JSON support go to my colleague Pavel Kuklov, who implemented it over the course of the past 12 months. He unfortunately caught the flu right before FOSDEM and was not able to present. Okay, let's start with the question, what is ClickHouse? ClickHouse is a database, and the cool thing about databases is that there are so many of them. So let's make this more specific. ClickHouse is a relational, columnar, shared nothing, and eventually consistent database for analytics. The important part here is that ClickHouse is columnar. The goal of ClickHouse is to provide super fast and scalable analytics over tables with trillions of rows. ClickHouse is open source. It is built in C++, and it runs on anything from a Raspberry Pi to clusters with hundreds of nodes. You can run and operate ClickHouse by yourself, for instance, at home or in a data center, or you can use ClickHouse Cloud, which is a database as a service where we, ClickHouse Inc., manage the database for you. On the right side, you can see the number of GitHub stars over time for different databases. ClickHouse is the red line. And you can see that ClickHouse is extremely popular within the space of analytics databases, as well as compared to Postgres and MySQL, which are more on the traditional end of the database spectrum. I mentioned that ClickHouse is columnar. This refers to the way the database represents tables internally. And it is best explained by an example. Let's consider the table with sales data on the left. We can represent it row-wise or column-wise. With row-wise storage, like in Postgres and MySQL, the table data is stored row by row. So in the example, the values of the highlighted row are all stored together. With column-wise storage, like in ClickHouse, the table is stored column by column. So we basically store the first column, country, followed by the second column, product, and finally column, sales. Which data orientation is better depends on your use case. Row-wise storage is great if you read and write mostly individual rows. However, if you're doing lots of full column scans and aggregation, which is very common in analytics, then column-wise storage will be much faster. The reason is that all the values within the same column are co-located and the database can use tricks like compression and vectorization to read columns super fast. All right, what is JSON? I think you all know what JSON is, but for the record, JSON is the lingua franca for semi-structured and unstructured data. It has its roots in JavaScript, but it found broad adoption as a data exchange format. The cool thing is JSON is human readable, but it's also machine parsable. And it's schema-less. On the right, you see an example JSON document. It describes the different properties of the first man in space, Yuri Gagarin. His first and his last name are modeled as strings. He is no longer alive, which we model as a Boolean. And he actually died quite young in a plane crash at age 34, and that we model as an integer. We model his birthplace as a map of key value pairs, and finally, we store his many awards in an array. Now, ClickHouse already provides data types to store strings, integers, maps, and arrays, but adding a dedicated JSON data type is not trivial at all. The problem is that the data models of a database in JSON don't match. ClickHouse is based on relational tables with fixed schemas. So you basically define your tables with their column types upfront, and then all the rows in the table will have the same structure. Now, JSON in turn can be anything and everything. It is schema-less. You could have two JSON documents with a completely different structure, and that's a problem. If you think about it, you may come up with a very simple approach to store JSON documents in a database. It basically goes like this. You serialize each JSON document and dump it into a string column. This is what the example shows. there are two JSON documents. We serialize them and we store each document in a string column. The approach is simple, but it's also extremely slow. Imagine we like to read a single field in one of the JSON documents. We will need to find, of course, that document within the column, but we will also need to deserialize the whole thing. And if you do that over and over, that comes with excessive deserialization costs, and it is not really an option if you want your scan, your search to be fast. But luckily, there's a better approach, and it views the JSON documents as a set of paths. We can then store each path as a column. Let me explain what I mean. And for that, I will go back to Yuri Gagarin. This time, I will add a second JSON document for Neil Armstrong, who was the first man on the moon. Both documents have the same structure, which simplifies things in the scope of this example. So what are our JSON paths? Well, the first path is first name. The second path is last name. Then we have a path is alive. We have path age. There is path born.country, path born.city, and finally path awards. Now, imagine we rotate the path by 90 degrees to the right. So we basically turn the path on the head. And what we get is what we store as columns in ClickHouse. The nice thing, if we do it like that, the nice thing is that this maps very naturally to the relational model. And even better, we can apply ClickHouse's super fast filtering and aggregation capabilities to JSON paths. So this approach is really tempting, but it comes with three challenges. Challenge one is when the documents share no common paths. So let's look at the orange box, the red box, and the green box. These are three JSON documents, but they share no common paths. This means we will not have two or three paths, we will have seven paths in total. And generally speaking, there is a risk that the number of paths explodes and we'll end up with an avalanche of columns and column files. Challenge two is when we do have shared paths, but they have different types. So let's look at the green box and the blue box. They have the same structure, but the path health score is in one document an integer, and in the other document, it's a string. And that's the problem, because a relational database expects that every column is of exactly one single type. And finally, challenge three is that paths can have very different frequencies across the JSON documents. Imagine there's a path which occurs in just one document. Its column will be empty except for one entry. And this is known and called a sparse column. And it's generally not great as the storage is made up of literally hot air. Okay. To solve the three challenges, we designed two new data types in ClickHouse as building blocks. And eventually we added a dedicated JSON type based on the building blocks on top. Both building blocks can also be used standalone outside JSON context. The first building block I like to talk about is the variant data type. You can imagine a variant as a union of multiple subtypes. Every value has one of the subtypes or it is null. Sounds a bit complicated. We will look at an example. So how does this work? Let's look at the yellow example column on the left side. You can see that it contains values of different types. For example, integers, strings, arrays. There's also one null value. The type of the column is variant of int64, string, and array of int64. Then you see the big black box on the right side. This shows the internal representation of the dynamic column. And there are two important data structures here. The first one is in light blue. And this is what we call discriminator column. It encodes for every value the type of the value. So in the example, one in the first row of the discriminator column means the value is an integer. Two in the second row means the value is a string, and zero in the third row means it is an array. You may ask how the types map to the type integers, and the mapping is actually implicit. So what happens is that ClickHouse sorts the names of the subtypes in the variant, and then it uses the relative positions as type integer. The other structure here is the offsets column, and that's the light gray box. It represents for every value its position in a subtype column. If you look at the bottom right, you see there are three yellow boxes, the small yellow boxes. There's a box for each subtype of the variant, and every box stores the values of a subtype consecutively. So for example, the leftmost yellow small box stores integers 42, 43, and 44, one after another. The offset column is now used to reconstruct the original position of the subtype values. It stores for each value in the original column the position of the value in its subtype column. Long story short, the variant data type in ClickHouse solves the second and the third challenge from the previous slide. The second challenge was that the same JSON path may have different types. So variant columns allow to have values of different types within the same column. The third challenge was that columns may be sparse. In variant columns, that doesn't happen. The data is always stored in a dense fashion. And that brings me to the second building block, which is the dynamic data type. Again, it can be used standalone outside JSON context. The dynamic data type is exactly the same as the variant data type. The difference is that it does not require you to specify the subtypes upfront. The dynamic type can store whatever data types you throw at it at runtime. If you look again at the yellow box in the center, that's the original column, you see that it has now data type dynamic. And we have a mix of different types again here. Because we no longer specify the possible subtypes in the type itself, we need to remember them somehow. And this is done by an additional file, which is called dynamicstructure.bin, and it is highlighted in red within the big black box. The file dynamicstructure.bin contains the contained subtypes plus some additional statistics. So in this example, we store an array of int64 and string as subtypes. Besides that, it also maintains various statistics that are needed to optimize the access later on. All right, now remember the first challenge about exploding path and column counts? We will now address this. The way we do this is that we allow to specify an optional upper limit on the number of subtype columns in dynamic columns. If more types than the upper limit are stored, we don't reject them, but we will fall back to a slower data representation. And to be more precise, all values of types which exceed the limit are stored together in a single column, and we use a very simple type value representation for them. Sounds quite complicated, so let's make an example. In the yellow box on the left, you see that we use the dynamic data type. But this time we additionally specify a parameter max types as 3, which means that at most 3 types should be stored in dedicated columns, and values of the 4th, the 5th, and so on type should go into a fallback column. So in this case, there are more than 3 types. These are the rows highlighted in green. And we store all of them together in the green file on the right. If you look at this green file, each value in this box is stored as a pair of the data type plus the value. So for example, the first row in the green box is a pair of date and 2020, 1st January, followed by a pair of bool and false, and so on. Okay, now that I introduced the dynamic type and the variant type, I can finally present the new JSON data type. Generally speaking, each pass across all the stored JSON documents goes into a dynamic column. And this is how you formally declare the JSON type for your table. There are five parameters. In green, max dynamic pass specifies the maximum number of pass stored as subcolumns. In the interest of time, I will not explain today how this mechanism works in detail. In red, there is max dynamic types, and it specifies the maximum number of types for a single pass stored as subcolumns. If the limit is exceeded, new types are stored together in a fallback column. And this is what you saw in the previous slide. Then in blue, there is some pass type name, which states that certain paths should not be stored in a dynamic column. They are instead stored as a regular column. And this is really nice if you require high performance for selected JSON paths. And finally, in purple, skip and skip regex means that these JSON paths are completely ignored, or in other words, they are not stored at all. Now, I will show you this end-to-end example for the JSON data type, but I will not explain it in detail because of time reasons. The gist of this figure is that we have six different JSON documents, five paths, and we store every path in a dynamic column or in a dedicated column if the user requested that via parameter of the JSON type. If you'd like to know more, please see the nice blog post about JSON support in ClickHouse, which we have recently published. You'll find the URL at the bottom of the slide. The last thing I like to show is a benchmark for JSON documents, which we recently published. The benchmark compares the native JSON support in analytics databases. It runs queries over a data set with 1 billion blue sky events modeled as JSON documents. The total compressed data set size is 125 gigabytes. Everyone is free to grab the data from our public S3 bucket and reproduce the measurements. So we compared the query performance of the new JSON type in ClickHouse versus Elasticsearch, DuckDB, MongoDB, and Postgres. And you can see that ClickHouse runs the JSON benchmark by far as the fastest database ahead of all other databases. To sum up, ClickHouse now speaks JSON. The implementation is easy to use, it is flexible, and it is extremely fast. JSON support is currently in beta, but it will be GA in 2025. That is it from my side. Thank you for listening and have a great day.